This is Athletes as Educators with former pro basketball player, championship winning coach, and author Angela R. Lewis. Angie Lewis interviews current and former athletes who are passionate about sharing the lessons they've learned and the experiences that have shaped their lives. A resource for parents. A guide for student athletes. A source for current and former athletes. Keys to transition off the court. Welcome to the Athletes as Educators podcast with Angela R. Lewis.
Welcome to this episode of Athletes as Educators. On our podcast today, we have Layshia Clarendon. She played basketball at Cal Berkeley, then was drafted to Indiana Fever and was traded to where she is now with the Atlanta Dream. Layshia, thank you so much for joining me.
Hi, thank you. Happy to be here.
Layshia, will you talk a little bit about when you started playing ball and how you fell in love with the game?
That's a great question. It certainly takes me back to the slab that my dad had built in our backyard, just concrete slab with the hoop we had up, with the light hanging for the nighttime so we could see him still shoot hoops. And I just played for hours and hours and hours, mostly against my cousin who is 1 year younger than me, and we just play one-on-one and 21 and just over and over and over, I think, until it was time for bed and we had to go inside and eat dinner. Your parents call you in. So I just fell in love with playing. I just love to play, always.
You know, it's so funny because I ask just about everyone that question and they laugh and there's this nostalgic moment and you can hear it in their voice that they're visualizing that moment when they when they were playing. It's crazy how time flies, you know?
I remember my dad was actually a referee for 15 years, and so my older sister played basketball. She got tired of sitting at his games. She had to go with him because he was watching her. So she finally decided to play, I think, middle school or high school. And so then by the time I came around, 5-6 years younger than her, the ball was just handed to me from, the age of one, and I played ever since. And then my younger brother, so we just became the basketball family.
Right, I see. So you guys probably went through this whole college recruiting process. What was that like for you all?
It was cool to see my sister go through it first. And I remember my parents saying, you only get to come on one of the official visits. So, choose one. And she either went to Pepperdine or LMU were her two visits. And I went on the Pepperdine visit. And that's where she ended up playing college basketball for 4 years. And then, my goal when I came around was to go to, a better school than her, to a bigger school to kind of, beat out your older sister. And so I wanted to go to, a more known school. And I ended up going to Berkeley. And the recruiting process was actually, it was fun, but it was definitely a little stressful down the stretch with, the pressure of coaches trying to get you to come to a visit. You get five visits, and I remember thinking, I'm going to take all five. It's only five visits, thinking you only get five. And then once it got down to it, I actually took three visits, and I remember having to tell a couple of the schools no, and they were pretty upset about that. And, they kind of make you feel bad, and you're just an 18-year-old kid having to make these big decisions. And luckily, my family was pretty involved, so I had that love and support. And I know that's not always the same for everyone, but the visits ended up being pretty long and pretty exhausting, fun, but you get kind of tired, and it's definitely emotionally draining, and you're trying to make this big decision that's going to change the trajectory of your life for the next 4 years. So there can be some pressure behind it as well.
It is. There's a lot of pressure. I've seen kids literally break down and start crying at the thought of the idea of where they're going to go or not knowing how to make a decision. It's great that your parents were supportive. How did you decide what decisions to make? How did you, narrow down your choice? What were the things you based it on?
For me, it was not wanting to live the West Coast. So, it was like the Notre Dames or any of those other East Coast really good known schools. I was kind of like, I don't want to go far. And for me, it was wanting to make a school known on the West Coast besides Stanford, of course. And so I was like, I want to go somewhere and build something. UConn's great, Tennessee's great, but I want to go somewhere where they haven't won yet, where they haven't done something and make history. And so for me, it was one of the schools on the West Coast. And then it was either UCLA, Cal, or ASU. And after I just took those three visits, something just felt right about Cal. And for me, it was definitely a faith thing looking back. I didn't, grow up Christian. And after I went to Cal and kind of found my faith and found God, I realized that it really was a spiritual journey that someone was leading me there and guiding me there. And it felt safe. And it felt like that was the place that I was meant to be. And my dad, of course, and my mom wanted me to go to UCLA because I'm from Southern California. So they were all like, we can go to every game and it's only an hour and a half away. And I'm like, it's kind of too close. You know, like Berkeley was like far enough an hour flight home. So it was, you know, a 7-hour, 6-hour drive from where I live. So it was that nice balance between far enough that I can kind of live my life and do my own thing in college, but close enough that, you know, it wasn't a cross-country flight.
Right, right. Because some players just don't want to be that close to mom and dad. And
enjoy no, right.
A little freedom. You mentioned, you just touched on it, and you wrote about it in your article in the Players Tribune about how your experience in college reshaped you, and you mentioned just finding God. Will you talk a little bit about that journey and how you really found mm-hmm. yourself?
Mm-hmm. So my family, kind of typical Black parent, you know, every overstate Black person is religious in some form, or their family or their grandma or someone has some kind of ties to religion. So that was kind of my mom. She grew up Christian, and we only went to church, I think, you know, Easter, Christmas, and one other random time. And I didn't hate it, but I didn't know what was going on, and I didn't enjoy it, and I was mad I had to wear a dress. So that's pretty much the gist of it. And I was like, why is this lasting so long? So I didn't really grow up with that faith lens. And I grew up being LGBT, and so I had some negative experiences with when my older sister came out and kind of realizing that my parents were using the Bible in a negative way. And like, oh, what is this thing? Like, God doesn't like gay people? Like, this sounds kind of, you know, rude and scary. And so even with that, I always have had a really open heart to God and to religion. And so when I went to Cal, one of my teammates and now best friends, Talia Caldwell, went to this church called the Way Christian Center, as I talked about in the article. And I didn't go the first time. After she went, I think, I think I went out or I was tired or something. And she came back and she was like, yo, like, you've got to come check this church out. Like, it's so dope, blah, blah, blah. It's awesome. And I was like, oh, cool, for sure. Like, I'll go. You know, even having that kind of negative experience in the past of the things I've heard about God and religion, I still was really open. And I went to that church, and I wish everyone in the world could have that experience, because what those people showed me there, they became my family. They were so loving. And, you know, they weren't trying to convert anyone. You know, sometimes you can come to religion, and it's like, they're just nice to you because they want you to, like, say the Lord's Prayer and become Christian and, like, baptize you, you know? And so it was really genuine and authentic, and they really just were open and welcoming. And it was like, you know, this is this cool thing, and I think that's how everyone should experience God. And so for me, it was just like, oh, my God, this is dope. Like, God is awesome. So I just started to build a personal relationship with God, and I was just, like, on fire, and had a lot of faith, and I didn't know any, like, the Bible stories or any of that stuff growing up, so I was very childlike in my openness and, like, reading stories and learning about God. I was just like, what? This is so cool. And then, as I talked about, I think, in the article, I did struggle a little bit with, like, the social aspect of reconciling those two things, my sexual orientation and my faith, and so I struggled with that for a few years, and one of my coaches at Cal, Joanne Boyle, she was really influential in me feeling okay with who I was and just my mental health and my spiritual health. But I would sit in her office and cry, and she was Christian, straight Christian woman, and she would just be like, Layshia, it's okay, like, you're not going to hell. And she would just, you know, talk to me and counsel me and guide me, and she really, you know, helped me through that time, you know, to touch on the college athletes and how influential those coaches can be in that time when you're so young and vulnerable and you're trying to find yourself. Like, she's someone who I always look back and I'm just so thankful. And now I realize, like, she was there for a reason those first couple of years, because she helped me, you know, more than I can ever express. And then I finally kind of reconciled those two things after, you know, crying a lot, reading a lot of books, praying a lot, talking to her a lot, and my pastor. And, like, towards my junior and senior year, I just finally became very unapologetic about who I was, and I felt very, like, called that this is who I'm meant to be. And coming out of that, on the other side, it's kind of turned that one thing I thought that was going to keep me far from God was being gay. It was the one thing that drove me to discover God in new ways, and it's the thing that God's now using me to spread love and joy and change in the world. And so that's pretty cool to see.
That is. What an amazing journey, right, to go from not really feeling comfortable to being confident in who you are. And I think a lot of young women go through that unknowingness mm-hmm. to get to that mm-hmm. point where they really mm-hmm. stand firmly in who they are and what they believe. What's your advice for other young women who feel these tensions, whether it's sexuality, whether it's difficult, like not playing ball at all, whether it's being in a school that's totally different from where you grew up? I mean, like, there are all these situations that make us feel uneasy.
Absolutely. You know, typically it's your first time away from your family and your parents and your structure and everything you've known for the last, you know, 17 or 18 years. So it's definitely scary. But I think one of my main pieces of advice would to be to find some form of community that is loving and edifying, right? And so find a space where people are going to pour into you in a positive way. And first, you know, for me, that was my coach. And for me, that was that church. And I know sometimes churches can be a negative experience for some people, but, you know, try and find those people and those relationships that are going to be uplifting for you and not toxic, because you need all the guidance and the love and the support you can get. And, you know, that's different for everyone depending on where they go and what they're struggling with. And it might be church, it might be a friend group, it might be sorority, it might be an other group on campus, but finding some form of community where you can be open and you can hopefully find some love and some courage and vulnerability in a space that you can really be who you are. Because we all need help. You know, college is rough. It is a rough time in your life, and it's fun, but it's just looking back, I'm like, how did I do that? Like, how did I go through all these things? But it really did shape me, you know, the person I am today. But I needed that community, and I needed those people and those teammates to help lift me up and to help keep me going on those hard days. And, you know, my second piece of advice was to be within the community, whether it's counseling, you know, in college sports especially, the mental health aspect isn't talked about enough. So I struggled with that a little bit in college and just like, oh my God, this is difficult. You know, it's a grind, and how do you balance and struggle? And so I used the counselors we had at college to, you know, our health insurance, and it was called Paying Medical Center, and I would go and I would just talk to them about, you know, my team, whatever issues I was feeling like with the coaches, with campus, like I'm overwhelmed, and it was such a healthy space for me to get in. And so to not be afraid to reach out, because when you sit in it on your own and you stew in it, and then you get isolated and you feel like you're the only person in the world struggling with these things, but everyone's going through it some way or another. So talk to someone about it would be my advice.
Layshia, those two points are so profound, because oftentimes, to your first point about finding community, oftentimes athletes only hang out with their teammates or other athletes. Mm-hmm. So you don't have this other identity outside of sports. And having a totally different group of people who love you regardless of how many points you score is essential. And then
it's so important.
You know, the other thing you mentioned about actually going to see a counselor, there's this stigma around seeing someone. Now, did you go willingly, or did someone kind of nudge you?
They just told me it was a resource available. Like, I was talking to them about it. It was actually our trainer at the time, and I was like, I'm really struggling. Like, I'm losing my mind here. She's like, okay, like, you should go to Tang. You know, you get the first how many sessions free, and you have health insurance. Like, go talk to them. And I was like, all right, cool. Like, where do I sign up kind of thing?
Got you. So you were ready for it. You were like, I need to talk to somebody.
I just open. Yeah, I'm like, any help I can get, you know, help me. And so, but to address the stigma, I think, yeah, it is okay to talk to someone. There's a lot of stigma around that, especially issues of color. Especially sometimes in the faith community, we don't talk about it enough either. We're just like, pray about it, it'll be all right. Yep. Like, okay, that is a good solution. But there's also some practical ways that you can find help with people who are trained that is very faith-based as well, because God doesn't want you sitting there struggling on your own, crying on the floor, praying every night. You know, God's like, there are people, you know, you have to pray about it, but you can also go get some help with someone who is willing and ready. Absolutely.
That needs to be talked about a lot more often. I interviewed Shamiqua Holzclaw, and she's going all around the country talking about the mental health concerns that she had, that she lives with and had dealing with them when she was in college and playing professionally. And I think that's so important that it gets, that it's diagnosed and that you can get some help. This people can get help for it.
So absolutely. And where I always wonder, where is the accountability in college sports, and how do we start to address this in all of sports? But for me, it was especially in college sports, in terms of we exercise physically so much, right? The demands is like, you got to do workouts, you got to run stairs, you got to do summer conditioning, then we got spring workouts. You know, we're always working out year round, but we don't systematically address the mental health issues enough either. So how do we, I don't know if it's training, or I don't know if it's breaking that stigma, but how do we help hold, you know, these athletic directors and coaches responsible, trainers, everyone, you know, top down to help give these athletes that space as well.
Oh, we can dive deep on that. Let's definitely talk more about the college experience, because a lot of kids say, oh, I want to play Division I sports, but have no idea the intensity mm-hmm. level of it. And you're mm-hmm. absolutely right. Oftentimes, most times, it's all about your physical strength and ability. Rarely, mm-hmm. rarely is the mental health something that's emphasized. And hopefully it's changing. I mean, it's been over a decade since I've been out of college, so.
Right. And I had a positive experience. You know, I had trainers that were telling me, hey, here's resources. So I think that's something good to highlight, is that I had a great experience with that.
Did you guys have any training or coaching around transitioning out of college, prepping for that transition out? If so, how was it?
I know we had our, I can't remember the acronym, but it was like our student athlete, what is it called? Like your on-campus group. I might, Polly and my best friend was in it. It's like, it was like FAFSA, student athlete, something administrative, I can't remember, but she was in that. And so they would do some events around, I went to one that was around your resume. Mm-hmm. And so I went in, they had, so I brought someone in to talk about your resume, and this is what you should, you know, put on it, and not, you know, the stigma about athletes not having any real skill set. And so we talked about, oh, are you a captain on your team? Or did your team go top four? What did you do? Or you want a gold medal? Like, these are all great skills that you can put on your resume. So they taught us, like, you do have skills, you know, employers love athletes, time management, blah, blah, blah. You know, here's ways to use that. And so, and then I also went to an etiquette dinner that we had. It was really cool that they also put on. And so we had some events like that in our campuses. I'm not sure if it's all around the country, but I think for the most part, there's student-athlete organizations that put on these kind of things that I think oftentimes, you know, some accountability on the athletes is that they don't engage mm-hmm. them enough, and they don't sign up for them enough, or maybe they don't even know they're going on. They're just, you know, busy worrying about school and sports, and they're missing out on these resources on campus.
You're absolutely right. It's a balance, for sure. You have to go looking mm-hmm. for it, and then the opportunity has to exist for you to actually find it.
Right. Both sides, definitely.
Let's shift gears here just a little bit. You know, it's the 20th anniversary of the WNBA, which is amazing. Do you remember when it started, and what was your thought growing up around the WNBA?
I don't remember right when it started. I think I was 96, 97, born 91. So I don't remember exactly when it started, but I do remember growing up watching Sue Bird with my mom sitting on the couch. It's like a very vivid memory I have, is just watching summer basketball games in the living room. And the first jersey I had was a Sue Bird jersey, like fangirl all about her. And I wore that thing everywhere, and I put it up on my wall. And I just loved her. So when I played against her, you know, my rookie year, I was like, oh my God, like, this is so cool. I would say this is such a different experience for the generations that are younger, because, you know, Tamika Catchings, all this, like, the people way before, they didn't have the people to watch, so they were just watching the dudes, right? So then when they played, like, all the generations now finally have someone to look up to, and it's happening, you know, every year as we progress and get older. And so I always wonder what it would be like if people did interviews or podcasts around all the younger players, like what it was like their first time playing against, you know, their person or their idol or their role model or whoever they looked up to. Because I wanted to, like, not let Sue Bird score, but I also wanted to give her a hug at the same time. It was like this, like, mixed emotions of, like, oh my God, you know what, I love you, but, like, oh my God, I have to guard you now, I'm gonna get yelled at and pulled out of the game.
So have you told her since how much you idolized her, or is it still like you don't talk about that? Well, now it's
no, like, I have. Now it's out there. I didn't know, you know, my first couple of years in the league, like, I didn't really know a lot of people because I was from the West Coast. Like, we didn't play a lot of those teams that had a ton of players in the league. So I felt like when I got in the league, there's all these East Coast players who just, like, knew everybody. And I was like, all I know are the Stanford players from our conference, because we didn't really have a ton of people making it in the league, right? As now we're starting to see, you know, Oregon State be good and the Washington's be better and LA's are good again, so now we're starting to see more people pop up in our league, and, you know, Rashonda Gray and Brittany Boyd, my former teammates in the league. But in the first couple of years, I felt like I was like, I don't know anyone but my team, Indiana. And so in the last, like, year or so, I've started to be like, oh, like, I've gotten to know people, and, you know, you see them around after games, you hang out with mutual friends, and I actually had drinks with Stu in Indiana at the Final Four through, like, a mutual friend, and so I had to play it all cool, you know, and be like, oh, hey, just talking about basketball, but I want to be like, oh, do you know what, I love you, the first time I talked to her, so it was just really cool, and really chill, and so it was really fun to just, you know, hang out with her. It just sees you just a normal person, just like when people meet us, and they realize, like, we're just normal people.
Exactly. Now, that's really cool, though. It's cool to have those moments. I felt that way when I interviewed Shaniqua Holzclaw. That's exactly how I felt. I was like, all right, I'm just going to act like we're friends already, and then this won't be weird.
Right.
So I did tell her I had her shoes, and it, like, she was my favorite player of all time, but then after that, I was really cool about it.
Oh, so yeah.
Did. But it makes such a difference for us. And, you know, there are little girls who are watching you right now who you're going to meet 10 years from now, and they're going to have that same exact experience. Life comes full circle like that, you know?
Yeah, it's so cool. And, you know, representation is so important. Everything from, you know, women now growing up and realizing they have a W that they can play and they have a league that they can dream about being a professional basketball player. In the same way we see, like, Serena being, like, this strong, beautiful, powerful black woman that, like, little black girls I see, you know, holding their tennis rackets now. And I was at Target the other day, and I saw a little advertisement for one of those little rackets for, like, ages 5 to 12, and it had a picture of Serena and, like, a little black girl, and I was like, oh, my God, stop. Like, now she sees herself in that. You know, the movie Home, I went to see that, and it was a little black girl with curly hair, and I was like, you know, you need representation. And so for young girls, I think it's everything that this league exists.
It is. It's essential. You know, I think we can talk a little bit about the impact of sports on our culture. Recently, there was the media blackout that the WNBA players had, and we were like, rooting for you guys. Like, we're not going to talk about this until we address the social justice issues, right? I mean, we loved it. Mm-hmm. Can you talk a little bit about the decision to do that and how you all responded?
Yeah, just sports, you know, a lot of ways is a microcosm for a larger society. And in a lot of ways, we see through the NBA and the WNBA, you know, NFL, even MLB, how sports can affect the larger culture and how much influence we have as athletes and the platform we have and the sway we have with people. And so I think for us as a league, I think it was so exciting to see all these players want to get behind issue and to speak up, and I think that's kind of part of our generation now. You know, we're quick to speak up now. I think we're a lot less afraid for a lot of reasons, which are, you know, tangible, and through social media, I think it's just kind of breeding this really vibrant, outspoken generation. I think it's awesome, and it's definitely social justice forward. And so to see the ladies be like, oh yeah, we got to speak up about this, like, you know, you can't be silent on certain issues and not other issues. And so I was really excited. And I think, you know, there's some more things to come, but just to get us organized and to do the blackout, I think, to wield our power and to be examples. I think the W has done a great job with being examples for inclusion. You know, we did the LGBT pride campaign the last couple of years, and we're always the league that's, like, kind of pushing the sports world forward. And so for us to do this Black Lives Matter event, I think we're just being the leaders, and I'm so excited to be a part of a league that is always pushing the envelope forward.
Absolutely. You know, it's historic. I've never seen this before. And it's amazing to show the power of the media and the power of using your voice to make a difference.
Mm-hmm.
Because other people stand up. Other people are inspired.
Yes, absolutely. And stand up for what you believe in. I think that's such a cool thing to pass on and to be a role model for, to say, like, be passionate about something and care about something. That's what I always try and preach to kids or youth or anyone I talk to, is like, what do you care about? You know, what if you could wake up and do anything today, what would it be? If it's play basketball, or would it be change the world? And so you have this opportunity, we do as athletes, to make a difference. And like I think I told you before, it's like, people follow me on social media just because I can play basketball. Like, why? That's kind of silly, isn't it? Crazy? And we have this opportunity, and so what are you going to do with it? How are you going to use it? Are you going to use it for good? Are you going to make a difference? And I think that's a social responsibility that all athletes should, you know, take a serious look at.
The understanding that responsibility is so key, especially in the age of social media, when everything someone says can be broadcast. I mean, that influence is undeniable.
Mm-hmm. And it's scary. I mean, on some sides of it, it feels very unfair because, you know, you can tweet anything and it can be quoted, right? I can just tweet something because I'm upset or angry or even excited, and then all of a sudden, you know, anybody picks it up. The New Yorker says, Layshia Clarendon quote on Black Lives Matter. I'm like, I didn't say that. We didn't have an interview. But, you know, they can use that as a quote. So in some ways, we got to remember, and, you know, I know we have social media training in college, kind of like, hey, you know, be aware. Like, I always text my girlfriend when I'm really upset instead of tweeting it. Like, I was like, this is what I want to tweet. And then I'll tweet something more composed. But you have to be aware that, you know, what you put out there, even if you delete it, like, somebody's already screenshotted it and it's already floating around. So, you know, you have to be careful on the flip side of that as well.
Absolutely right. Let's talk about media. Let's start with media, though, for a second. In your blog, mm-hmm. you wrote about Sue Bird's article in the Players Tribune, and her article was so good. And she went on about how mm-hmm. they cannot find stats for women's basketball. Like, you could find any set you want for mm-hmm. men's basketball, but there are certain sets you just can't find. What will you talk a little bit about what you wrote and why this is such an issue?
Oh, God, what did I write? I don't remember.
It was essentially that Sue Bird is one of the best players of all time, and she should be able to find her stats.
Oh, right, yeah. I get upset about that a ton because, yeah, like you said, there's 1,000 stats you can find on efficiency. I feel like where a guy shot it off his left foot or his right foot, you know, was it his birthday or not his birthday? There's, like, these insane mm-hmm. stats on the NBA. I'm exaggerating, obviously. But, yeah, one of the greatest of all times. We have, like, the basic textbook of, like, basketball 101 stats, but the positive was this year the WNBA did come out. I'm not sure what their system is or what they use, if it's exactly the same as the NBA or not, but they did come out with a new software system to track more statistics. So again, the power of the media, I think, in the way Sue Bird wrote that article, because obviously she's one of the greatest and has a big influence, I think that definitely drove that conversation forward and brought attention to that and be like, hey, we need better stats, and, you know, and they delivered. So kudos to them for that. And I don't think they're the same as the NBA, but they are better than what we have, so it's awesome.
Before we go, I want to talk about what you do in the off season. So you're in the WNBA and you're playing during the summer, but what are you doing when you're not playing?
What I do in the off season?
Yes. Will you talk a little bit about the off season?
Mm-hmm. So I did an internship the last couple of years through the WNBPA, our Players Association, and the WNBA, they co-sponsor an internship in whatever you want it to be in as a career opportunity for players who don't play overseas. And so I took advantage of that the last 2 years. And the first year I did an internship with the church I went to in Berkeley all the way. And I did an internship around bridging the gap between the LGBT community and the faith community. So I did a little bit of everything, some normal church stuff and some work around that. And I led an LGBT Bible study. That was the first one our church had done. So that was really awesome. And then this last offseason, I did an internship with the Players Tribune. I was out there for a couple weeks, and I was with the editorial team. And so I actually got to help work on some stories and see how the process works from beginning to end. I do like to write a lot, so that was a cool opportunity. And then this upcoming offseason, I'm hoping to get the internship again. That would be awesome if I got 3 years in a row. And I'm looking to do it in personal training and posture and body functions as I started to discover a lot more of that about my own movements and our body patterns. And, you know, everything about basketball mechanics and the way our body functions is important, right? Because we land on one foot, we land unstable. You know, we're jumping basketball, such a crazy sport. And so it's really important about having proper body mechanics and proper posture and proper strength and stability. So I've gotten really interested in that. I think that could be a cool avenue. And so typically in off season, I try to do an internship and get some job experience and some work experience. And then I also just work out and work on my game. And that's been one of the reasons why I didn't want to go overseas, was because, you know, I saw my weaknesses in my first 2 years in the league. And I was like, man, like, I want to be good in this league. I want to be great in this league. And so what do I need to do to be better? Like, I saw weaknesses. I was just like, this isn't going to cut it. You know, I was doing things in college, and I came to the pro, and I was getting blocked. Like, wow, this is okay. A whole nother level. And so I was like, oh, I need to get better. And so I took the last 2 years to get stronger. So I was, like, tiny and getting thrown around everywhere, and then to get better at my game. So by not going overseas, I had the chance to really watch a lot of film and break down my weaknesses. And like, all right, Do you need better going left? Do you need better off the ball screens? Like, and there's so many different schemes in the WNBA that it takes some time to adjust. And so that was an aspect. And then gaining weight was and muscle was a big form for me. And I ate a lot of food, like a horrible amount of food that I had to eat. Because gaining weight for people who struggle with it is really hard. Like, it's a very diligent process of like meal prepping and meal planning and eating when you're like tired and you kind of feel like you might throw up your food. Like, you have to keep eating because you have to get enough calories to put on the muscle you need. And so this is really tough, but I made it and I kind of transformed my body, and I've gotten so many compliments this year about it, and I'm so much stronger. I don't get bumped as much. I've gotten the most and-ones I've ever gotten. And so it's really cool to see that all pay off.
Now that is pretty cool to have. That's cool. And typically we only hear about players going overseas, but I love how you took a dedicated off season to train and work on your game. Often young athletes don't take breaks to just focus on skill development.
Absolutely. And it's so tough with the W because, you know, we have this chance to make a pretty good amount of money overseas. And so it's that hard balance of, like, you know, not blaming the athletes, but then also understanding, you know, why I did it. But I also understand why players do go overseas. You can make six figures playing for 6 months. Like, I'm not mad at you. But for me, it was a personal journey to be like, hey, you know, it doesn't matter to me if I can play overseas the next 5 years and then I get cut off the team, right? Because I'm not good enough, because people have gotten better. So for me, the most important thing was staying in the W. And for some players, if they get cut, they play overseas and they're fine with it, you know, and that's cool too. They're still professional basketball players. But for me, it was like, the W matters. Like, I want to be at home playing in front of my family and my friends. Like, I want to be overseas in some country all alone. Like, I just want to make a decent amount of money here. And like,
each person has their own decision about what is the priority for them.
Absolutely.
Layshia, I just want to thank you again for joining me. I really enjoyed our conversation. You dropped some wisdom. And if people want to learn more about you, want to learn more about all that you've done, how can they reach you?
My social channels are great. I don't have an official website, but I'm all over my Facebook, my Twitter, my Instagram. My Twitter, my Instagram are just LayshiaC, LayshiaC. My handles are all the same. And you can find me there, tweet me, message me, DM me, whatever, and I'm typically pretty responsive because I love the engagement, I love the fans, I love the community. So let me know what you think, and let's chat.
This is Athletes as Educators.
Thank you for listening to the Athletes as Educators podcast. Connect with me with the Athletes as Educators Facebook page or at Athletes Educate on Instagram. Be sure to subscribe so that you never miss an episode, and go over to iTunes and leave us a 5-star review. For more resources and information about today's podcast, you can check us out at AngelaRLewis.com.